No Jumper, coolest podcast in the world. And we got motherfucking DJ Paul in the building today. This is crazy.
What up? What up?
Paul, man, it's crazy to have you in here. You know, we interviewed Gangsta Boo before. We had a lot of people that are like clearly, because we interview a lot of underground rappers who are like clearly so influenced by 3-6. But sometimes it feels like they might be kind of far removed from the original influence. I'm sure you know how this works. You've been in the game.
What about that too young?
Yeah, yeah. So they don't necessarily know that their style, especially in the underground, sort of derives from a movement that you were pioneering in the fucking late 80s.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of people don't know. They just think that it comes from other things that they hear, and but they never know where it originally comes from.
Right. And yeah. It originally comes from what? You just in the streets of Memphis. Can we talk about like your early days when you first fucking discovered music?
Man, my early days, man, I discovered music, man. I discovered music. One of the first records I fell in love with was LL Cool J, I'm Bad.
Okay.
And Public Enemy, you know, all of the Public Enemy, you know, Yes, The Rhythm, The Rebel, all that, you know what I'm saying? All Public Enemy. I still go bowling on Thursdays with Flavor Flav.
You do, really?
Funny enough.
Wow,
yeah.
Okay.
But I post pictures of it on my Instagram. But, I love Public Enemy, and then one of the really, really records that people don't know that really, really got me was a record from a guy from Atlanta. I'm not sure if he really, really is from Atlanta. He told me the story a million times, but I was drunk when he told me, but he live in Atlanta. A guy that was signed to Luke Skywalker Records, so we thought he came from Florida. His name was MC Shadi.
Okay.
And MC Shadi back in the day had this song called Gotta Be Tough. Uh-huh. And he had this Earth, Wind, and Fire sample in it, like, like that. But his voice was like, and it's John D, and I gotta be tough. I'm finna buy, finna. He sounded like he was 12, and when I was listening to it, I was 12. Come to find out, the nigga was about 30 then. No, he wasn't about 30, but he was probably like 19 or 20 or something. MC John D, my man, now we talk on Twitter and on the phone and all that, and I tell him how I started rapping because I thought you was a kid, and I was like, if this little kid can do it, I can do it. That was one of the reasons why I started rapping. But I started doing music way before that. I started doing music back in the days of listening to Michael Jackson and Prince.
Okay, so you had influences before you started really listening to hip-hop?
Yeah, yeah, way back in the day. I mean, I grew up on 80s music. When MTV first came out, I was alive.
So
I was young as fuck.
Off.
And my mom would just, you know, get me out of the way. She would just plop my ass in front of the TV and turn MTV on, and then she would go do whatever the hell she had to do, and then I would just sit there, and I would just watch MTV over and over again. That's why I always won the argument when people would be like, who came out first, Prince or Michael Jackson? And they'd be like, Michael Jackson. I'd be like, no, it was Prince. And Prince was on MTV before Michael Jackson. Nobody knew that.
Why is that, though? Just because that's how it came out, like, chronologically?
In the order them niggas got signed.
Because they were, like, protests. They weren't feeling rap music in the early days of MTV, right? Like, do you remember
it was impossible back then.
Right.
Yeah. It was impossible back then.
Interesting for you, too, though, because you're talking about LL Cool J and Public Enemy and shit. Did you not have a lot of rap influences coming from down south because it just hadn't really managed to, like, bubble up?
Well, it wasn't rap when I was young, when I was a kid. We didn't get rap until in Memphis until 1990 is when we got, like, our first popular Memphis rapper.
Right. And that was when you started to realize, like, that you could actually do it too. Did it seem like strictly a New
York thing
before?
When I started trying to do it before that, and the funny part about it is that dude. I'm not gonna say his name, but the funny part about it is that dude ended up being the person who helped me get to my first demo situation. My demo. I ain't gonna say demo. I ain't gonna give him that much credit. He hooked me up. He asked me to be in a group with him, me and my brother Lord Infamous. And we did like two songs together with him, and then we saw it wasn't going to work. So we stayed in touch with the studio engineer / DJ who he took us to.
Okay.
And I started going there on my own, paying that guy $40 a song to record songs.
So it was basically there was another guy that tried to give you a little bit of opportunity. That didn't work out, but that gave you the understanding of like, this is how making a song works. I could get in the studio on my own.
He didn't give me an understanding. He just hooked me up with a studio that, that worked for cheap. I already knew the business because I got a, my uncles had a real popular gospel group called the Bogard Brothers.
Okay.
And they had already set me down and taught me publishing and this and that. And I have,
so you come from like
yes,
a
I come from a musical
music.
Background. Okay. They had already shown me how to press up your own cassette tapes.
Right.
And this and that because they had those. But that dude just hooked me up with a studio that was in a back of a dude's mama garage that I could come there and give him $40 a song and record. And he had every record in the world. So, like, I would just go over his house and just go through records and listen to shit. And I would just start creating loops and then build shit around it.
Right. So when you first got in there in the studio, what was, like, your style, if you had to describe the kind of music you were making?
It was horror music. Yeah, everybody know that.
But so you went to that.
People know what it is. It was it was a cassette tape, an EP that me and Lord Infamous came. It's on eBay right now. The EP that me and Lord Infamous brought out called The Serial Killers.
Okay.
The Portrait of a Serial Killer.
Right.
The group was called The Serial Killers. Portrait of a Serial Killer was the EP, and it was three songs with me and Lord Infamous.
Right. So, like, between that and Mystic Styles, like, how much progression took place? Because that was the first, like, real album, right? Because that's always, like, the oldest 3-6 shit that I have on my computer.
Yeah, that was the real, real album. Right. But it was a lot of shit that went in between it to build that. So, before we made Mystic Styles, I was up to, so this was the order. We made the Serial Killers mixtape, not EP, that we put out for sale. And that was in, like, the ninth grade.
Uh-huh.
And then between that, I couldn't afford to keep bringing, because they had the cover, the hard case. It was a real cassette.
Yeah.
Shrink wrapped and everything. I couldn't afford to do that, but I still wanted to make music. So what I started doing, I would go to Sam's Wholesale and I would buy TDK tapes in bulk. And I bought a stamper.
Right.
And I would just get a stamper that said DJ Paul Volume 1, just well, actually, before I got the stamp, I would write it on there. That shit took forever. I did that for maybe like 7 volumes.
And you were just selling these in school and shit?
And I would just write it. I made volume 1, and I would sell them at school during lunch. So volume 1 started off like this. It was my first tape after that EP. And it was only the TDK tapes back in those days was 60 minutes, right. 30 minutes per side. And I only did one side. And then it was a mixtape. I only did one side. And then I would sell it at school for $2. And then people be like, oh, man, it ain't got number one side on it. And I'd be like, well, if you want the other side, you got to give me another $2 and I'll make it. And that became the list price for all the mixtapes in Memphis. Me, Juicy J, Squeaky, everybody sold our stuff for $4.
Right.
And that's what the stores would give us. So we started doing consignments with the stereo stores. And that's when it went up to different volumes, and once I got to volume 16, that's when our music had progressed so much it was the sound that you hear today.
Right.
And that was in 1994.
So you feel like that, like, you established something then that hasn't necessarily changed that much? Like, you had the formula and the sound by that point.
Yeah. And there's a lot of people still don't know that formula and that sound.
Right. They're trying to put it together, but they're not really doing it.
Yeah,
exactly.
They're still
right.
Trying to get it. But, you know, this shit
were you,
was made
were you making serious money in high school?
Yeah, fuck yeah. Fuck yeah. Yeah.
And were you
when I was in 12th grade, I probably had 50 grand.
Really?
Yeah, I had a $10,000 car, man. I had a lot of money, man.
And were you the only motherfucker in school who had money like this?
Yeah, I was the only
person. What
else
were you
going to
do at
like
that point besides selling
drugs?
Wait,
is that all of $2 mixtapes?
$4.
$4 mixtapes.
But I was up to volume 16.
Okay.
And we were selling thousands of these tapes. So that's how we got our record deal. That's how we got our record deal. We got our record. It wasn't a record deal. It was a distribution deal. And they just came. I went to a company, and I was like, look, we all put our records in stores, and it was like, well, we don't do rap. It was the family that put out Elvis Presley in Memphis,
okay.
The Phillips family.
But this was the only record label that you knew about, so you
figured
you had to get a
shot. Yeah,
it was
the only one
that
I could drive up to. Like, I couldn't drive to New York City. I couldn't drive to New York City. I couldn't drive to California. But I can drive to Bartlett, Tennessee. That's like 30 minutes away. So I drove over there, and they was like, well, we don't really do rap. We put out one rap record, but we don't really do rap. But if you guys put your own money behind it, you know, we'll distribute it for you. And I was like, all right. So me and Juicy went into the studio, and we put $4,500. He did like $2,250. I did like $2,250, whatever. We put $4,500 behind that one Mystic Styles tape. And that 4,500 turned into about 45 million.
But so, okay, from the early days, it was like, were you and Juicy like the figureheads of the whole thing? Or like, how did this all come together? Yeah.
We was. If you remember, because we was known for the, even though everybody did parts in making the group what it was, that's why we named it Mystic Styles. We just had to, me and Juicy was the ones that was always the CEOs, even when we was on cassette tapes, and we didn't even know what CEO meant.
Right.
We thought it probably meant cassette. Cassette era is over, but we was always the CEOs. We was always the ones that put the money behind it. We wrote the majority of the songs. We made all the beats.
Right.
This and that, and Lord of us wrote a lot of songs too. Everybody wrote songs. Koosta wrote songs, but me and Juicy always led the projects and told everybody like this would need to be the next move and this and that. So that's how it went.
Right. And so did you when you started to like, did you always have the mentality like I need to find more artists and I need to like become not just a rapper but also like a label person who's gonna have roster of talent? When did that start to occur to you to like bring all these other people in?
Never. The only reason we brought in other people because I'm still not like that. Till today, it's a million kids ask me to sign them every day, and I still don't do it. You know, I'm gonna sign a couple of guys, you know, this year and next year, but just really not into it. But I was never looking for that. You know, good things gotta already be there. You know, a lot of times you be looking for things and it's already in front of you the whole time. So how we came into producing other people is because back in the day, 3-6 Mafia was called 666 Mafia. And it was like 20 of us. Mm-hmm. So once we got the group deal pretty much in place, we scaled it down to the best and most loyal people. And then the ones that wasn't a 3-6 Mafia member, we produced them on the side.
Right.
So you had to make cuts, basically.
Yeah.
Was that hard?
I didn't have to make cuts. The cuts was already there. There's other people that was already solo on the mixtape game. But we just put them out.
Well, what do you solo not, albums. What do you not like about doing the A&R thing? It's just the dealing with the fucking young people and everything. It just like takes away from you doing your own music?
No. I like doing it when you can find somebody that's level headed, this and that, because the thing about most arts, especially music, a part of entertainment that's mostly ran by alcohol and drugs.
Yeah.
The most talented ones are the most drugged out ones.
Right.
You know, you're never going to find the one that graduated from high school and got a degree at Harvard and he make the best songs in the world. Because he don't know what the hell to rap about. What are you going to rap about? This equals that and all this algebra shit? Fuck no.
Econ final?
Like all my years in the rap game, I noticed that the kids that come to me with a fucked up demo, like for instance on the movie Hustle and Flow that we won an Oscar for, the guy came to him with a fucked up cassette tape, you know, not a CD and this and that. And in real life that happens. So the guy that comes to you with like a fucked up CD where he ain't got no money in his pocket, he scrapped up, robbed, killed a couple of people, and made a fucked up CD with just a magic marker wrote on it, be the best shit. Versus a nigga that got the album cover with the pressed up CD with the jewel case and this and that and everything and the posters to match. And he got his social media jumping. Well, not jumping, but he got it put together. And, you know, and he spent too much time doing other shit. When the other dude that didn't have the money just went in there and be like, look, he ran up on somebody. Break yourself, fool. Break yourself. He took $500 off this nigga, and he went and made a demo tape, and he brought a CD, and he got the hardest shit because he got shit to talk about.
Yeah.
He just got out of prison. He could talk about that. He can talk about people he killed to go to prison. And, you know, but, you know, that's just how it goes.
There's like a direct link in the music industry between being kind of fucked up and being
It's like rock. You know? Yeah. It's like rock. It all comes from rock music. You know, rock music and soul and all that was first. You know, all that was first. And we all grew up on that. Even the young kids that didn't grow up on it today, they still live rocker lives. Yeah, you're saying like that. The rockers set the bar for music.
You're saying like the art comes out of the pain and the struggle.
Yeah.
And you're saying as a label head, you've got to deal with these fucked up guys and you don't really want to do that, right?
Not at this age.
Yeah.
Because I did it for so long. You know, 3 6 Mafia, man, was hell. Everybody was high. All of us was high. All of us was high, man. You know, it was crazy. So at the state of my career now, like the state of my life, rather, not my career, the state of my life now, where I don't have to deal with that no more, I don't want to deal with it. You know, I brought the group back together, the Mafia 6, and it was cool. It was fun. It was just made to be a one-off project. It ended up being two. That was too much. But it was just made to just be a one-off project, and we go in and do it and be done with it because we know how we is. If we acting a fool about to kill each other high at 20, what you check a motherfucker out in their late 30s.
Hey, so let me ask you this. So
with kids and child support to pay.
A lot of people might say that Lil Wayne lost his spark when he got off the lean or when he got sober or whatever, when he went to jail or whatever. Now Gucci Mane's out, and a lot of people are looking at Gucci. He's rapping completely different now that he's sober and everything. Have you seen this happen a lot of times where it's hard for artists to make a transition into a healthy lifestyle and still relate to the kids?
Lil Wayne did that. Lil Wayne didn't fall off.
Well, like, I think some people would say that as a rapper, his stuff became a little bit more, I'm not saying I necessarily agree, but, you know, it became a little bit more formulaic, whereas at a certain point when he was doing all the mixtapes.
Who knows if he's still doing it or not?
Yeah. A lot of people are secret drug users, huh?
Yeah, I mean, I've did some secrets. Yeah.
I'm on 12 Zans right now.
I know a lot of celebrities that be like, you know, I kicked it. You know, you got to do what the probation officer want to hear, man.
Right, a lot
That's
of times.
That's not the end of the story. Like, fuck the fans.
Right.
We love the fans. The fans matter. But at the same time, you got to tell the fans what you got to tell the probation officer because it's social media these days.
See, it's easy to believe Gucci Mane because he's in such great shape now that you're like, wow, you must have made some big-ass changes or something. Yeah. He was in jail for 3 years, too. So,
yeah. The nigga wasn't eating them steaks like he before he got out.
Well, there's something
RP,
there, too.
Shout out to Gucci Mane, man. That's my nigga.
Yeah. Paul's like skeptical about Gucci Mane's sobriety. He's like, yeah, we'll see. We'll see.
I'm not going to say that he stopped doing drugs or what he did. I never knew what he did. You know, it wasn't my business. I just knew that he was a good friend of mine. And
yeah, this is kind of a random tangent to go down. What was your relationship with him like? You meet him like forever ago? Did you guys ever work together at all?
Yeah, a long time ago. Yeah, we did a bunch of songs together.
Yeah.
Gucci Mane, Gucci Mane is one of my favorite artists.
Really? You say that?
Yeah.
That's dope. That's good to hear. Let's talk about drugs, though. You guys were real serious about drugs from the beginning? When did that become a part of your life?
From the beginning.
Yeah.
I would say I took my first drink in the... Just no, I did. Not I'm going to say. I took my first drink in the sixth grade.
Uh-huh.
And how I got that is my brother said... He walked outside. It was me and Lord of us. We were sitting on the curb. It was late at night. We were supposed to go to school the next day, but we were still sitting outside. My mom didn't care as long as we was in the driveway.
Uh-huh.
And my brother said, let me borrow your bike. I'm finna go to the liquor store. I'm like, no. I'm like, you're not going to bring my bike back. My brother, he had been in and out of prison. He was a pimp. And he's like, nigga, I'm going to bring your bike back. I said, no, you're not. And he said, if you let me borrow your bike, I'll let you taste some of the liquor when I come back. And I was like, what kind of liquor? He said, Cisco. I said, what kind is that? He said, it's a good kind. Just let me borrow your bike. And I was like, all right. I let him borrow the bike. He went to the liquor store. He came right back. Man, he must have gave me a load of was Cisco. We was headbutting each other on the toilet, throwing up all fucking night. And my mama, I couldn't go to school the next day. My mom was like, what's wrong with you? I don't know why she couldn't smell the liquor on my breath because I was in the sixth grade. I probably only brushed my teeth twice a year. There's no telling. But
twice a year.
You know, kids,
they don't want to believe that you're doing that, huh?
Yeah, kids, man. You know, they don't want to believe that. I had to make myself be like, boy, go in there and brush your teeth. You're sitting there playing video games. I'm like, when the last time you brush your teeth, boy? But anyway, I was like, I'm sick. I think it's just the food. I think I blamed it on the barbecue ribs or something, man. But, you know, in the South, we eat all kind of shit that it make you throw up. But I was fucking throwing up. And then she let me stay at home. And then I didn't drink again from the sixth grade to years and years later when I met, I would say, no, that's a lie. Well, yeah, it was kind of like when I met Juicy. When I met Juicy, I started back drinking more. I went to more weed smoking.
What age did you meet him at?
I met Juicy in like 10th, 11th grade, like 11th grade.
What was your first impression of him?
He was cool. He would come over to my house and he would ask me to help him make beats. And he was cool. He had a lot of good ideas.
Right. Do you feel like you would have like necessarily known what you were doing or gone in the same direction music-wise if you hadn't met somebody that was sort of like a kindred spirit in that regard?
Yeah, of course. Of course. Because I was already you know, super musical. Like in the fifth and sixth grade, my daddy made me take organ lessons.
Right.
And
so you have the background.
So you can read music too, right?
Yeah, so I can read music. I can do a lot of stuff that, you know, a lot of other producers can't do. So he would come over to my house and I would help him make beats. And that's how our bond began.
Right.
But we had already kind of had 3-6 Mafia before that. It wasn't 3-6 Mafia, though.
666.
It wasn't 666. It was just friends. Because we already went to school together.
It was Friendship Mafia.
Yeah, Friendship Mafia. I like that. That was much more positive.
Would you guys get together, like, smoke weed and then create? Would that be a part of the process? Or was it just like studio weed was for fun?
That's what people do these days. Yeah. We was already high. Then we would make the music.
Right.
We didn't plan on making the music. We'd just already be high, being like, hey, man, I can listen to this beat I just made. Oh, I made a week ago. I just forgot to tell you.
You're a kid. Like, making music is just like it's what you're doing all the time, right?
Yeah, I didn't have nothing else to do. I had no bills to pay, no job to go to.
Yeah.
My parents had a little money. They didn't have a lot of money, but they had enough money to, you know, to have us eating good and living in a cool house and this and that.
What was it like? What was it like smoking weed in Memphis in the 80s? How did you get into smoking weed? What was it like?
I sold weed in the 80s.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And what was the game like? I'm sure it was a lot different
than
now.
Fucked up. Like a joint costed $1.
Really?
Always.
But it was a lot of money back then.
Yeah.
You could get $5 if you made a rocket. So it was like a real, real long joint about the size of this. Like 6-inch long joint.
Right.
A rocket.
And do you remember so you started out selling it before you really were smoking it?
Yeah, because my brother, I had a brother named Phil D who I talk about in a lot of my songs. He sold cocaine and he went to the feds for selling cocaine. But anyway, with him selling cocaine, people gave him weed all the time, just gave it to him. And he was like, I don't sell weed. I don't deal with weed. Because back then, in those days, weed wasn't popular.
It wasn't.
Cocaine was the thing.
Right.
So he would just take the weed and he'd just give it to us. And I was in like the fifth, sixth grade, and I'd be like, I don't know what to do with this. He'd be like, you roll it in this paper right here and you smoke it. That's what you do with it. I'm like, okay. So by the time I got to the seventh grade, I didn't smoke it in the fifth or sixth grade. When I got to the seventh grade, that's when I finally learned what to do with it. Because I had a girlfriend named Teresa. I'm not going to say her last name. But she was up on game already in the seventh grade. She was a weed head.
Teresa.
Teresa.
Boy, that sounds
hey, you never gave me that pussy, too. All that weed. Whatever you're at right now, I still take that pussy. I don't give a hell how you look. Just for revenge.
For the memory, yeah.
But anyway, Teresa never gave me the pussy, but she would smoke weed like a motherfucker. So in the seventh grade, my girlfriend was my biggest customer. And but that's the good part about her. That's why she never gave me the weed. Because she was smart. She was smarter than me. She was like, if I give him the pussy, he's going to
cut it off. Yeah.
He's not going to want me to pay for the weed. So she like, I'll just get this nigga his dollar for his joint, and I keep this pussy, which is worth more than a dollar.
You got finessed by Teresa.
God. She was reading the Laws of Power book for any of us know about it. Because in the Laws of Power book, it says sometimes you got to not accept the free lunch.
Right.
And basically it's telling you, like, when somebody be like, hey, man, can I take you to lunch? Be like, no, because you're trying to talk me into some shit that I don't want to do. I don't need a meeting with you because I don't want to be in business with you.
Don't let somebody have something
on. And that's how she was. She said no to the free blunt or joint in those days. And she was like, you know, instead of giving you the pussy, I just pay for your weed. I give you this dollar and you go by your way and I go by mine. Damn, that was a smart bitch.
It's been weird for you seeing weed become so trendy and become like such a huge thing that everybody just talks about all the time in rap, or what?
No, it wasn't weird for me. I mean, I was selling weed in fucking the 80s.
Yeah. But was it weird to see it become cool?
It was always cool. It just wasn't It just wasn't public like that. I mean, it's weird to see it be sold at a fucking 7-Eleven damn near. Yeah, because you got a lot of motherfuckers. I got a lot of friends that's spending the rest of their life in prison for getting caught with a fucking roach in an ashtray.
Yeah, it's insane.
And they should let all them niggas out.
Yeah.
They will one day.
Yeah. Wait. It's got to be coming.
I got a question. This is what people like. What they really want to know. How did y'all get in that dark shit?
We got into the dark shit because, for one, Memphis is dark. And for two, I think it kind of came from my daddy sending me to play organ lessons.
Oh, okay.
Before, like, guitars or pianos or something.
Okay.
So that's a great question.
That's a creepy instrument.
Wow, that's a creepy instrument on its own. So when I'm sitting in my mama's living room, I'm playing, listen, watching Star Wars and playing the Darth Vader soundtrack. Yeah. It's turns. That's the only thing I know how to play. I didn't know how to play nothing else but the organ. I didn't have nothing else at the house. I still got that organ right now in my house.
Wow.
In California.
Nice.
I gave it a new paint job. It was an old ass ugly brown. I painted it all black and I put my mom and my daddy pictures around it. But I still have that organ. Man, you should have saw the movers trying to move that. I'm going to tell you this funny story. The movers just had to move that organ. And they was like, why do you still have this old thing? I said, it got value, sentimental values to it. Now get the fuck up out of here.
It's an antique, yeah. What are you wondering? Like, I still got this old ass thing.
Nothing else in the house. Just all of a sudden you're in this beautiful house and it's just an old organ sitting over there in the corner. Like, what the fuck is this creepy shit?
Yeah, imagine getting too fucked up, passing out at your house, waking up, you're playing the organ in the living room, and the whole house sounds creepy.
Well, it'd be cool for me, but what if you got guests over?
Yeah.
And you got the candles lit, and then I start playing it.
Yeah.
And everybody wake up like, uh-oh, Paul is high. Uber!
But so that sound was, like, totally different from everything that was popular at the time or whatever. Did it ever occur to you that you were doing something completely out of the box?
Yeah, of course. Because it didn't sound nothing like, you know, like what groups was putting out then.
Especially in the late 80s, 90s, I mean, it was nothing sounded like that.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing.
And just slowly, did you ever feel like tempted to go in like more mainstream directions, like especially once you got signed and stuff?
Nope. Because we had other artists in our cities, in our city, in Memphis, another set of artists, a group in our city, and they was like, they would have a bunch of music and all kind of guitars and singing and shit in their records, and they would always be like, just that nationwide shit. Three's Mafia shit ain't nationwide. That's that shit that ain't gonna go nowhere. And they shit end up not going nowhere. And our shit blew the fuck up.
Yeah, something when you try to appeal to everybody, you appeal to nobody. And if you just
when you're trying to do something that everybody always doing, you're wasting your time. Yeah. You gotta you know, unless you're gonna be a wrestler or something, then I mean that's cool because there's no left or right with that.
Unless
you go to UFC or something, boxing or whatever, but when you're talking about music, man, you could go for days. It still ain't areas of music we not hit. We haven't hit. You know, the human brain haven't got to it yet.
Who's out now? Like, who are you listening to now?
I listen to a lot of artists out right now, man. I would have to say one of my favorites who is not a new artist. He's younger, obviously younger than me. But he's not a new artist to the game. But I would have to say he's one of my biggest. He's one of the artists that I'm a big fan of, and I would say that's Waka Flocka.
Okay,
The reason why I like Waka Flocka is because Waka Flocka, he came out and he did it a little different. Like, he made, like, a song, I think it was called Tear Your Club Up or something, where he kind of redid. I ain't going to say it was a redo of Tear the Club Up, but he... Fuck the club up. Yeah. So he kind of redid Tear the Club Up, and he brought back the crunk that we was doing when crunk was straight dead.
Yeah.
Like, when people was like, 3-6 Mafia never come back, and these dudes are over, and they dead. Waka Flocka brought crunk back, but a younger version.
I think a lot of people said that. People said 3-6.
No, they did say that.
They did.
A lot of people had doubts about Waka, but then he put out Flockavelli, and it was just like, he just hit on something of like really pure aggression in hip hop.
But then Waka took it to another level and extra killed him when he started doing the EDM shit, which that's something that I started back in 2008.
Yeah, you did the first rap.
So I
kind of
look at
Waka
as like a young version of me. Like,
you said you did the first rap.
When I take a piss, he take a piss. I drink milk, he drink milk. Order pizza, he order pizza.
You look at him like he's like the younger version of you in a sense. Like,
yeah, I do
actually.
Spirit, yeah, I do. We got the same spirit, man. I need to do one of those like little tree checks.
Yeah,
I might see that Waka Flocka probably is a son of mine. No, I'm joking. I know Waka Flocka's mama. She real cool.
Oh yeah,
but
Deb.
Somewhere in there, he might be like a family member of mine or something. But I liked him because he always went to the left a little bit and did stuff that everybody wasn't doing. But at the same time, he still did what they was doing. So he still had the stuff that the young kids was doing. But then he had his twist on it.
He had some interesting influences, though, because he had his mom who knew like everything about the music industry, and then he had Gucci and all these dudes. Like,
yeah, he had a family.
Yeah.
He had a strong family. I still remember when Waka was just a dude in a tank top
in the
quiet in the back of the Gucci freestyle video.
He got like a black messenger bag on with a strap and shit.
Yeah, you never knew.
Once you're a rapper, they don't let you hold the bag
slick,
like that anymore.
Hood goon in the bag will be the nigga that rise like a motherfucker, man. That's why you can never, man, you gotta watch your bridges, man. You can't cross them bridges. You can't burn them bridges.
Yeah.
You never know.
What about cocaine, like early on? When's the first time you tried that?
I'm gonna tell you how I tried cocaine for the first time. I was a long time ago in 1995. I was going to get my third tattoo. My first tattoo is this barbed wire around my neck.
Went straight for the throat. Wow.
Went straight for the throat. Just sitting at home watching Dusk to Dawn movie and fucking George Clooney had one on his throat and his hand. And you could see the tattoo coming out of his sleeve where he wore the black jacket the whole time. And I'm like, damn, where we live at in Memphis, it's always raining or cold or something. So I said, I need tattoos that you can see when I'm wearing my big coats, like George Clooney. I told George Clooney this story when I met him at the Oscars. We'll delve into that later.
Wow.
Anyway.
Table that,
Anyway, I got this tribal on my hand because he had tribals coming down his arm, out of his hand, out his sleeve.
Sick, yeah.
You could see it coming out of his sleeve, and he had the thing on his neck. I didn't get tribals on my neck, but I got that's too much bodybuilder shit. But I got the barbed wire on my neck because I was like, the worst pain in the world probably would be being hung by barbed wire. Because where we from, they was hanging niggas back in the day. They still are hanging niggas if they catch a nigga.
With barbed wire?
Not with barbed wire, with a rope.
Yeah.
But imagine if they did with barbed wire, that'd be pretty fucked up.
Yeah, that sounds extra horrible.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But anyway, I got the barbed wire around my neck. So we went and got the tattoos, and we wanted to go back. We got addicted to tattoos after two tattoos. I'm like, damn, that's pretty cool. We paid the dude to do the tattoos with cocaine. So I was like, fuck, we were just chilling at the house. We had a little extra cocaine laying around. I'm like, fuck, let's take this and go get tattoos. And it was like, yeah, let's go. So me, Crunchy Black, and my boy Get High Chris, we got in my Suburban. And we ended up getting pulled over by the police because we was in the projects. And I'm like in a $75,000 car, and some spots that only cost like $100 a month. And it didn't look right. So the police ended up pulling me over for expired tags, the expired sticker on the tags. they found two Rugers with infrareds in the stash spot. Only reason they found a stash spot is because my dumb ass was high, drunk, and threw the dope in the stash spot. And then a dog sniffed out the dope and found the guns. I was like, fuck me sideways on rubber crutches. It was over with at that point. So,
how not to use your stash box.
Yeah, yeah, don't use your stash box for drugs, man. Jesus Christ. But after that, I spent about 3 days in jail, and that's when we was bringing out this our second album called The End, and we got like our biggest advancement in the world. We got like 6 digits up front, and I was still a kid, and I called Juicy from the jail phone, and I was like, Juicy, you went to Selecto Hits? They gave us that money for real, 6 digits apiece. And he was like, yeah, I got my check. Yours sitting up there waiting in the little mail slot. I was like, fuck! I was like, man, I got to get out. I'm like, hey, man, I got to get out of here, man.
I'm a millionaire.
I'm like, shit, I got to get out of here, man. Fuck me.
That's brutal.
And after that, I said, I'm never going to jail for little stupid shit no more. So that's when I got my boy Get High Chris. We were sitting in his driveway one day, and he introduced me to cocaine. And I was like, hey, this shit, you can't smell this when the police ride up on you. 5-0 can't smell this. And I was like, this is what I need. Because the reason why I went to jail that time is because they smelt the weed.
Right.
And I was like, this time they won't smell the drugs. I was like, give it to me. And then from that point on, I said goodbye to weed and hello cocaine.
Right. But so at that time, like, how'd you feel the first time you did it? Were you just like a big fan of that rush?
Well, anybody tell you the first time you do cocaine, you never feel it.
Yeah?
Yeah, the first time you hit it, you don't feel it. You be like, man, this is nothing, man. This is bullshit. I've had a million people tell me that.
Yeah.
They tell you about that about weed?
Some people are saying
they lie their ass off about weed. You don't feel weed.
I felt like I didn't really feel the weed the first time. I think I definitely felt the coke the first time. But
I didn't feel the coke the first time. Not the first time I hit it.
Yeah.
The second time I hit it, I felt it. Because you always, the first time, you be like, man, this ain't nothing. Man, fuck this shit. Give me some more of this shit. Then you, boom, 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 boom. Then you be like, oh, my God. Like, you start fucking singing shit from your past and shit. Like, it's fucked up.
I just always think of 3-6 as being like a group that, when I listen to it now, I see all the drug references to like hard drugs that I didn't see when I was younger listening to it. But I also felt like at that time it wasn't like normal or considered cool for rappers to be acknowledging actually doing hard drugs. They would talk about selling it, and they probably were doing it, but they wouldn't really talk about doing it that much.
Yeah, when we made Sippin' on Scissor song, Pimp C said, and Pimp C had hung around a lot of rappers, and Pimp C said, man, you know what I like about y'all niggas? He said, because y'all niggas actually rap about hitting that cocaine and doing them drugs. We was making Sippin' on Scissor song. He like, man, a lot of these pussy rappers out here, they getting high all the time, but them niggas scared to talk about that shit.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, even now. It's very uncommon for rappers to really talk about doing coke, even though you know they are low-key.
Yeah, they doing coke like a motherfucker. They just don't like to talk about it because they don't want to make it look like they are a cokehead. But yeah. See, when I grew up, you know, in the 80s, we grew up watching Scarface.
Right.
And see, back in the day, cocaine was a rich man's drug.
Yeah.
It was a rich man. The weed was for bullshit garbage niggas.
Right.
And the cocaine was for the rich man. If you could afford the cocaine and you get you a good big-titted, blonde-haired chick and you feeding her cocaine or sniffing cocaine off her titties and
you're
sucking cocaine off your dick, like, that's a good time.
Yeah.
Like, you can't do that with weed. Like, you're not going to put weed on your dick and let her light that motherfucker up. Fuck no.
You never smoke weed off a stripper's tits?
Fuck no. You know, I would have did that, but OJ fucked it up for everybody, so you can't put your hands on a woman like that no more.
What do you mean OJ fucked the game up?
Because you can't touch a woman no more like that.
But you could before, kind of?
Yeah. Pimps could.
Yeah. OJ changed the... How'd you feel about OJ when that shit all went down? That kind of coincided with you, like, making your emergence in the rap game in a way.
Man, you know, I don't know what OJ did. Nobody knows if OJ did it or not. And then they brought out this TV show. Now everybody all of a sudden wants to say OJ did it. Because of a TV show? There's a fucking actor right here, man. this is written. This is black and white. This is on a pen and paper.
I remember being the biggest fucking OJ fan when I was a kid. I wanted him to be innocent so bad because I just saw it the way a lot of people saw it, which was like, this is...
He was innocent.
Yeah. I mean, he got off. Like,
yeah, exactly.
But that was extra stressful on race relations too, because you had a whole country that was sure that he was guilty, and then he gets off innocent. It's like they don't know how the fuck to feel about it. Yeah.
Nah. It was just a weird thing overall. It was just fucked up.
Yeah. Did the coke get real bad for you guys for a while when like everybody was doing it and stuff, and everybody starts wilding out and screaming at each other all the time and shit, or what?
Did the coke?
Yeah.
No, fuck no. It got better for us.
It got better?
Yeah, coke is a drug that'll never get bad for you unless you do too much of it.
Yeah, honestly, there is. That's like scientific.
But you know what? To
that's
be scientific. Honest with you, like, I don't do coke no more like that. But to be honest with you, coke is a better drug than coke, than marijuana these days.
In what way?
Because cocaine, if you have a good night with cocaine, you won't touch cocaine for a while. You'll wake up with a headache. You'll be like, oh, I'm never getting high again. Jesus. You can get high, and then you would never do it again until you end up somewhere in the club, in the bathroom, with that one friend of yours that do it all the time. And then you drunk, and then you'll be like, okay, fuck, I'm going to hit it. Or you at his house, at his mansion up in fucking Hollywood Hills, and then he got all these pretty bitches around there, and they're doing coke, and they be like, hey, boy. They got these funny accents. Hey, boy, do you want to hit it? I'm like, why not do I not want to hit it? Give it to me.
You spend a lot of time around a lot of girls that
are Russian women.
So anyway, but weed, you can get high as fuck off weed.
Yeah.
You can go to sleep for anywhere from 15 hours, and you'll wake up and you'll want more weed.
Yeah. There's like not enough side effects.
Do you do dabs at all?
I did them sometimes. Dabs is strong, though. Strong.
That's crazy.
Now, dabs is like the cocaine. Like, you can do that, and you'll be like, yeah, I'm cool for a minute. Like, you'll walk in the room, your boy be like, hey, what do you want? I'm like, no,
I'm fine. Yeah, I'm but fine. If there's blunts going around the room and you got like 30 seconds or a minute to rest in between, it could be hard to smoke a whole bunch of your face, you know, if you're not fully experienced. But if you got it going around the circle and you got this little break every for a minute, you know.
Yeah, you
got a
break, it's cold.
Get right back into it, yeah.
Yeah, but if it's just you and one other nigga, you'd be like, nah. Oh, just you? Fuck nah.
It's like there's not enough side effects of weed, so you can. It's like a good drug for overusing it. Yeah.
Yeah. See, yeah, because drugs, you don't have headaches, and you don't have a snotty nose, and you kind of end up being in a mirror, like holding one nostril, trying to blow that shit out all fucking day.
It's better to do drugs through your lungs than through your nose. I think, generally speaking. The nose is not really meant to have a shitload of powder going up it all the time. You always know these people, they got fucked up noses after a few years in the game.
Yeah. Yeah, they should start getting ate up on the inside.
Yeah. What about, you got any crazy tour stories? Like, you were on tour for so long. I feel like there's just got to be stuff that we could talk about that happened on the road with 3-6. Like, just so many crazy characters.
I heard, like, in the studio, y'all used to get crazy in the studio. Like, the engineer would get his dick sucked while somebody recording. I heard y'all do some wild shit in the studio.
Yeah, I can't speak on that. I can't speak on the studio. But now I tell you, like, tour would be crazy. I tell you this one funny story about the tour. We was doing this college in Georgia, and then one of our guys brought, he wasn't even a group member. He was just like a roadie or whatever you want to call him. He was an assistant.
Yeah.
And you hear that pulling?
Yeah, for the SoundCloud listeners. Is that Henny? Or what is it?
Some stuff.
Pouring up?
Yeah, a secret. Secret potion.
He's got a secret potion.
Secret potion. So anyway, one of our guys brought, we had a bunch of guys with us. And we was down in... Georgia, we had just did a college, an all-white college, and it was like 15 niggas, us from Memphis. We was like the only niggas, yeah. So one of the roadies, or a couple of them, whatever, brought a couple of girls back to the room, and they was hanging out with these girls, this and that, or whatever. And the girl ended up sucking one of them dick, And that's the funny part about it. When she was sucking his dick, he thought that she was going to swallow it. So he's like, oh, I'm about to come. And soon as he said it a couple of times, she jumped up. And the cum went, boom, and hit this nigga on his head, on his own head. Everybody ran out the room like, oh, shit. He said, like, fuck you, bitch. She got up. This shit was crazy.
I could imagine.
Nigga cummed on his own. You ever seen a nigga cum on his own face?
No. No,
like, you watch porn and you'll see a nigga cum on his, on a girl face, but I didn't see it, but.
Wait, everyone was in the room watching it, though?
Not everybody. Okay. Like, me and Juicy went in there. It was just like the extra, guys, the Rose, the homies, the posse. Nate ran to our room and told us, they like, man, this nigga got scotch on his face, man. He got scotch on his face, man. This and that. That shit was funny as fuck. I was like, oh, my. I was like, this is literally that, like, Hollywood couldn't make this up. This is the fun, like, you couldn't, this is like, the, Something About Mary is one of my fun, my favorite movies. They couldn't have made that up. A nigga nut on his own face.
So that, I know, I like, you really gotta appreciate a girl that's down to give a guy a head in just like a room with like other dudes just hanging out and stuff. What's the craziest shit you've seen groupies do, like, not involving you necessarily, but just situations?
Man, I seen them do anything you name. Just name some shit. Jump out of a helicopter and land on a dick. I've seen it. I've seen it, man. Anything you can name. I've seen a girl do. I've been doing this for 26 years, man. I've seen a girl do anything that's possible for any human being mixed with a leopard and an elephant can do.
Yeah, what's the weirdest thing you've seen put into a vagina?
Wow.
I haven't seen a lot of that because I don't be around a lot of that crazy shit. Like, when you get to doing that, that'll start to look like some abusive, crazy shit. So, like, you know, you can't tear the pussy up. We got to preserve the pussy. I would say the craziest thing I've ever seen is just, like, some girls sticking beer bottles up in them. That's the craziest thing I've seen as that. But I don't like to see nothing too crazy. I saw a girl, you know, obviously smoke the cigarettes, smoke the blunts with it. I saw a girl stick a snake in there. That was pretty crazy. I was like, damn.
Snake? Yeah. The tail?
She stuck the head in there.
Wait, but
when I was a kid, I used to DJ at the strip club. Now, it wasn't even a strip club, to be honest with you. It was like a little weird kind of club that had these girls in it that they didn't strip down like that. They had on a, you know, top and bottom, but they would, I DJed in there when I was young. I was like 15 or something. And I wasn't even supposed to be DJing in there. And I was DJing up in there, and the girls would dance with these snakes. So I guess it's kind of like the movie Dusk to Dawn, but like an earlier version of it.
It all comes back to that movie.
Yeah, but
just keep going.
Yeah, but when Selma Hayek probably wasn't even born yet.
Yeah.
But they would dance with these snakes, and then they would pull their vaginas to their panties to the side, and they would stick the snake head up in their pussies.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Guys throwing money for
like,
that?
Damn. Like, I was like, I want to bang one of these chicks because you can go straight on them because he probably done ate everything in there that can make a baby.
I was going to say, yeah, you're going to get like
so
a
like,
snake
this
STD
the bitch you
want to
stick a raw dick in. Damn, I'm like, this the hoes you raw dog right here. I like it raw.
So you were DJing clubs since like the
I've been DJing
beginning.
Clubs since I was probably like 14.
Wow. And, like, would you always, like, you bring your records in at that point, right? The crates and crates?
Yeah, back in those days, that's how the entourage was created. When you see rappers rolling with posses and entourage, it was created because you had to have so many niggas to carry the milk crates that you stole from behind the grocery store with the records in it.
Damn.
And that's how it was created.
Are you jealous of, like, kids these days creating music on their computer in the bedroom, or do you feel like...
No, I love that.
Was there something, too, though, having to go to the studio and, like, have that extra, like, get out of your bedroom and, like, you know, save some money up to, like, really make a song? You know, do you think... Was there something to that? Like, to make
What's
a better
that
song?
Say that part again?
Like, if you... Do you feel like a kid, like, doesn't, like, maybe value it as much, making a song these days, as you did, like, when you were starting?
No. Because if that was the case, you'd be like, I hate that kids got a touchscreen phone, and I used to have to do the. I don't wish that on nobody, man. It was fucked up.
Yeah.
My dad used to call me in the living room. I'd be in the back trying to make a beat, and my dad would call me in the living room, and he said, "Paul, come in here and change the channel on the TV." And it was a cable box where you had to be like, and you would have to, it was just a cable box that had all the channels on it. And it had like 1 through 100. And you had to move this little level to each channel. So I had to go to 3. He'd be like, "Nah, I don't like that. Go to 4. Yeah, it's all right. Go to 10. And I would have to sit up there until my daddy found a show that he liked. From 1 through 100
yeah.
on cable. And when he found a channel he liked, I would go in my room, work on a beat for 30 minutes, and that show go off. Then I had to come back in there and again. I'd be like,
imagine having a kid and getting them to do that for you.
Kids, man, so kids lazy. Wouldn't even do that these days.
Exactly.
They'd rather run away from home.
Yeah.
They'd be like, "I would rather sleep downtown L.A., Los Angeles," well, it was really called Lost Urinals because the whole fucking area smelled like piss. I found that out. I'll come to y'all's studio today. But Lost Urinals. I would rather live in Lost Urinals than to fucking...
His experience. He's been around the block. He's been in some bad areas. He was a little taken aback by this downtown Skid Row thing.
I've been down here a bunch of times, though, Skid Row. I've been down Skid Row a million times. I just never had to kind of walk down it. Like, I had to... walk down. But the interesting part, though, me and my homie that came with me, Andrew, we saw a dude, one dude that had a long stick, long as a baseball bat, finna fight another dude, and the other dude only had a beer bottle in his hand.
Wow.
And the only reason I didn't videotape it because the light had turned green about 3 times. And I'm like, "Look, we're probably going to get a ticket if we don't hurry up and fucking move. But I want to see who's going to win this. This is pretty interesting. Because if this dude with this beer bottle win... with a dude that got like a 4-foot stick in his hand, that's going to be some fucking good ass fucking YouTube Instagram for me.
Right there, yeah. You got the Instagram clip going crazy. That'd be beautiful.
Yeah, I had one go crazy, but that would have been my best one right there.
Bat versus stick.
God,
gone wrong.
That'd have been like a, you know, Rottweiler fighting a Chihuahua.
Yeah. Hey, so like you guys, when you said you got that deal and you each got 6 figures each, is that the first time that you felt like, "Holy shit, I'm really rich off this music shit," like getting just a crazy amount of money at one moment like that?
Not really, because we had already made that kind of money kind of building up. That was just the first time we got it in one whop.
Right.
And see, in the music business or any kind of business, you never want to get a bunch of money in one whop.
Right.
Because if you get it in one whop within that year and you don't have enough shit to write it off, then the IRS is going to come and they're going to take half of it.
Yeah.
Especially if you live in California. You know, California alone, certain tax brackets, you got to pay 12%. And then you already got to pay almost 40% to the government. So like now 52% of your money is gone. So you don't never want to get a lot of money in one whop. That's the reason why 3-6 Mafia, or you know, at least the members that took care of themselves, like me and Juicy, is still rich today, is because the money came slow over years.
Right.
You know, we never made like $20 million or $10 million at one time.
Right.
It just came slowly, slowly, slowly over the years. And when it comes slowly over the years, it gives you time to figure out other shit to do with it.
Right. That's a really good point, because there's that show, The Lottery Ruined My Life. You give someone who has like $10 in their bank account $40 million, they're going to end up dead in like half a year because they're going to go crazy, you know?
Yeah,
like,
so getting a bunch of money at one time, I never was into that. I don't want that. I don't, no. I like it slow. Slow and low, that's the tempo.
Yeah.
I think I stole it from a song.
When did you first start to feel like famous? Like, you know, at what point did your shit really start to get on the radio and you started to really feel like, damn, like we're becoming mainstream, like national celebrities?
That was in 1994 when we had this song that we made back in the day called The Summer.
Uh-huh.
The Summer started playing on the radio a lot in Memphis. Out of nowhere, they just started playing that song. And I was like, damn, We didn't even work at the radio. Back in those days, you didn't have to work at the radio. Back in the day, radio, if you had a good song, they would play it on the radio.
I had no idea that song.
These days, you got to suck a dick, stick $100 in an envelope inside the 12-inch case cover when you give them the LP at the club. Oh, yeah, you got to do all kinds of shit. You got to talk to a million kids day and night on Facebook, whatever. You got to do a lot of shit to get that these days. But back in the day, if you just had a good record, it just worked.
Right.
Like, you didn't have to be up to 3-4 in the morning. Like, hey, y'all, good night. What y'all doing? I'm going to bed. I just left the studio. But
you felt famous because of radio airplay, but then when do you start getting recognized? Because of the videos? Or?
Well, we was always recognized in Memphis. I was recognized in Memphis since, you know, like I said, 10th grade or whatever.
Right.
And that was all that mattered to us because that's all we knew.
Yeah.
But now, in 1995, when we made a Mystic Styles album, we made the single out there called Tear the Club Up. Mm-hmm. And that's when life really changed. And that's when we started to go do shows out of town. And our first set of shows that we did, we would always go to this college called TSU, Tennessee State University. And we had these kids up there that went to the college that would book us, and they wouldn't even give us hotel rooms. Like, we stayed at their mama's house when their mama's was out of town. One of them was so cool because his mama had a DeLorean in the garage, and I was like, fuck, like, we're not getting paid. We don't get paid like $1,500 a show tonight, but I mean, I wish I could get this fucking car right here.
I thought you were gonna say that he let you whip it around the block or something.
Fuck, I don't even think the damn car worked. It was just sitting in the garage. It was just a classic that she kept. But, man, we even did it. Once we got to the point where we started making money, we did shows for shoes one time. We did shows for...
like a lot of shoes, hopefully.
Live? Why is everybody fucking texting me right now? Hey, man, shout me out. Stop, nigga. I'm doing an interview right now. That's how it be when I be on the radio in Memphis. I got a radio show in Memphis. Everybody start texting me all night. Texting me. Shout me out, man. Shout me out. But anyway, what... it's getting ridiculous now. It's got to be my probation officer. Like, hey, man, you're not at the house, man. I see the thing.
You're on probation right now?
No, I'm joking.
Oh.
But like, it was funny,
still
though.
Still getting
right?
In trouble, yeah. All right.
Fuck no, man. I got enough money to buy my way out of that shit now. Like, but
you
got to
be past that point in your life.
Fuck that. But one time we did a show for just tennis shoes. It was these new tennis shoes that was out, and we had money by that time. Not a lot of money, though, but we was like a little popular. We was like, man, you don't even have to pay us. Because we were just happy. It wasn't about the shoes. We were just happy to go outside of our city to do shows.
Right.
And then it was shows with college chicks. So, like, we would do the shows at his mama house. And then he would have, like, a small little party at the house after the shows. Where they would bring, you know, we would come back. And that's where we would spend the night. And they'd bring, like, 30, 40 fraternity chicks and this and that. And, like, we come from Memphis, from the hood. We never went to college. We didn't know what the fuck this was. We was like, damn, chicks in college, like, easy like this? This is the greatest thing in the world. We thought it was heaven. So, it was cool for us.
You ever get burnt by a groupie or a fan?
No, fuck no.
No?
You got to wrap it up with them.
Yeah.
100%.
You can still get burnt, though.
Yeah, you can still get burned.
Some kind of way.
Yeah, you still get crabs.
Yeah,
you can use condoms. You can still get crabs.
Yeah, you ever had that experience?
No, I haven't. But you gotta don't wish that evil on me though. Don't. Rick and Bobby.
Crabs is such an old school STD. I feel like.
Yeah, crabs. I don't think I know anybody who's ever had that.
I feel like they all died off.
Actually, no. I think Tax Stone talked about having it on the podcast.
The guy I work for has crabs.
Right now?
No.
Oh, he's just walking around with it, just rocking it. That's lit.
Here we got to tell him to go get the cream, man. $7. What dude said on a scary movie? He said, all you got to do is get the cream, $7, and you rub it on overnight. And
you a big movie fan?
I am a big movie fan.
Yeah? What kind of, like, what are your favorite titles?
I like comedies, man. I like anything about Farrelly Brothers.
Uh-huh.
Farrelly Brothers. How do they pronounce
Farley?
It?
Is it Farley? You know.
I think Fairly or Farley.
Fairly?
Farley.
Sure, my bad.
Anything by them. I like comedies.
Right. You ever get tempted to, like, make another movie after all these years?
I've been wanting to make another movie. I've been wanting to make a horror movie.
Yeah.
I've been advertising, and we actually started writing on it. I just got to figure out how I'm going to put it out because You don't make no move, no money. It's crazy these days.
You probably made a shitload of money putting out the movie back in the day, though, right?
We put out 3 movies back in the day. Yeah. We made a shitload.
Yeah.
Like, they were selling for $20 a piece. We did joint ventures on them where we got $10 of them. And we got, 2 of them got double platinum plaques, and one of them got $100,000, yeah.
And that was like, because back then it was like you're making like
early 2000s,
good movies though. That actually appealed to people in that situation. Like, it wasn't many. It was very, very few. So, like, somebody, like, on your level that you could actually pull it off, like, it was probably...
Yeah, our movie Choices was considered, like, the hood Scarface.
Yeah.
It's still considered that. People love that movie.
Yeah, I love that movie. It's been a while since I've seen it. I'm trying to fucking remember details about it and shit, but, like...
How do you get into the barbecue game then, with like the spices and everything and the sauces and everything?
Oh, because I moved to California and then I didn't have access to the good barbecue out here.
Oh, okay.
It's a good barbecue out here, don't get me wrong.
But it was done out of necessity.
It's not like the South. Like, you'll go to a barbecue restaurant out here and it'll be like, you got a dry rub on it? It'll be like, yeah. And it'll be just salt and pepper. Like, right. Okay, what the fuck is this? It's not a dry rub, man. I mean, I can put salt and pepper. I got the shakers right here on the table. I can do this my goddamn self.
Yeah.
You have to sell me on this.
You spend most of your time out here now?
Yeah.
You miss a lot of stuff about back home?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Is it tough, though? Is it like everything about moving back?
You know, the most important thing that I miss about from the South being in California is turn signals.
What do you mean?
People using
them? We use those here, too, theoretically, right?
Yeah, y'all use them all right.
Yeah.
Y'all use them to speed up on the motherfucker that's trying to get over.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So if you put on your turn signal in California, that speed up on you like, oh, no. So you can't use a turn signal in California. People out there listening, if you ever come to California, don't use turn signals.
Right.
Hopefully LAPD won't get mad at me for saying this, but... They'll tell you. I mean, it's just better to just vroom, just go over, just bogart with, just vroom, just go over when you get that little space. Because if you put that turn signal on, it'll wake them up. They could be asleep. They could be on Facebook, driving, texting, anything. But if they put that, if you put that turn signal on, they'll wake up like, oh, shit, not today. You ain't going to get me.
You appreciate the more laid-back driving style back home?
I appreciate back home when you turn on the turn signal, somebody slow down and let you by.
The courtesy, yeah.
Everybody nice and, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And the good food, obviously.
Yeah, the food is a big one, huh? Yeah. What's your favorite place to eat out here? Or are you kind
of I got tons of them out here. I go to every restaurant out here. Every single one, from the hood to Hollywood. I go to all of them. I can't tell my secrets because then niggas be showing up at it.
Yeah, I feel you. Can we talk about the Grammy? Like, we're an hour in, so I want to make sure we cover like the highlights so that we don't like miss anything too serious.
You mean the
here.
Oscar?
The Oscar shit, my bad. Yeah, it's been a long day.
Yeah. The Tecate starting to kick in.
Yeah, it's kicking in hard.
Tecate.
No, it's just like, I don't know anything. I don't know the difference between a Grammy and an Oscar. Like,
man, you know what? It's not you. Nobody do. People come up to me. My best friends have come up to me and be like, man, let me see them take a picture with that Grammy. I'm like, nigga, it's not a Grammy. It's an Oscar. Like, read at the bottom right there. You're holding the motherfucker.
But it seems more likely that you would get a Grammy anyway. So it's
because it's music.
Yeah, yeah.
I never won a Grammy.
Yeah.
Yeah, they never gave me a Grammy. But it's the Oscar, though.
Yeah.
Basically, it was I was sitting in my bed, laying in my bed in Memphis, Tennessee, and it was about maybe 4 or 5 in the morning, and maybe 7 in 7-8 in California, and John Singleton called Juicy, and then Juicy called me, and Juicy was like, "Wow, we nominated for an Oscar." And I'm like, "What?" He said, "We nominated for an Oscar." I'm like, okay, cool. I said, let me call you right back. I'm sleepy as fuck right now. And then I pulled up my phone and I looked at it. I'm like, holy shit. I was like, I thought he was just talking about some local hood shit. Like, like some kind of local little war where they go to the little trophy place next to the karate place. You know, there's always a trophy place next to the karate place right, where they give you those little things. My son got a ton of those. But I was like, what? And I was like, the gold, man. And then I called him back. I was like, what the fuck are you talking about? And he's like, we're nominated for an Oscar. And I'm like, for what? And he was like, for Hustling Flow, this and that. Like, what? This and that. So blah, blah, blah. So anyway, they called us to fly to L.A. And they just wanted to make sure we was clean. They wanted to make sure you didn't have no warrants. Because obviously they don't want you to have no warrants. You get, you know, you go up and you accept an award. The police would love to run up in there.
It ain't like the Source Awards where they'll like arrest you right afterwards out back or whatever. Yeah, they want to check you out first.
So they wanted to make sure you was clean, you had a clean record, and you was some nice, respectable dudes. They flew us out here and they saw that we was cool and this and that, and they loved us. So when we was getting ready to leave, I was like, so what y'all want us to wear? Y'all want us to wear like suits or something? And it's like, no. We want you to wear street clothes, just the same way you dress all the time. I'm like, for real? I'm like, that's going to be pretty weird. I was like, damn. But anyway, they told us that, and then we had the Oscar luncheon where I got a chance to sit down with George Clooney, which that was super, super cool. Because at the Oscar luncheon, like, you can't sit with – it's a lunch that they throw for all the nominees.
Right.
And you can't sit with the other people in your crew that you nominated with.
Oh, really?
They mix you guys up.
They mix you up because they say they want to make a friendship between everybody.
The whole dinner party thing.
Yeah, probably so if you win, the other person won't jump on stage and knock your ass out. Like, you motherfucker! Like, and I was going up against my girl Stop it. Dolly Parton.
Really?
And so they probably want Dolly Parton to come up there and knock my ass out, man, and float my ass. Hey, you know, like 9 to 5 style.
Was the weird part about it that wasn't by far, it wasn't even close to your biggest hit. It wasn't like the biggest, most recognizable song from you guys, and they still won it. That was like the strange part about it, right?
Well, no, that wasn't the strange part about it because you can't get nominated for an Oscar for a song that's already out.
Right, yeah.
So there's a lot of people that had big songs out that was already out before the movie came out, and they end up using it in the movie and became a big hit.
Yeah, yeah.
But that don't count.
Right.
It got to be a song that you originally, that's why the title is called Best Original Song for the Film, so-and-so, so-and-so.
Yeah.
Because it got to be a song that you write just for that movie. Right.
Was there a seat open next to George Clooney? You're like, oh, I got to go tell him about my tattoo.
No, it's probably a sign,
did
right?
Did that just happen kind of randomly?
No, I told you they seat you.
So yeah. They just,
where they want to seat
that's
you.
That's awesome, yeah.
So like it's 6 people at this table or whatever, and 6 at this, 6 at this, 6 at this, blah, blah, blah. And they seat me with George Clooney, which was cool.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, look. And he was real, real, super, super cool. And I'm like, man, I got to tell you about this fucking tattoos I got because of you and this and that. And he was just laughing, this and that. And that's why when we won the Oscar, I sent a shout out to him. I said, I want to send a shout out to George Clooney. Everybody like, okay, that's pretty random. They probably thought I was going to name like a 7th Street Projects or something. But I named George Clooney. And they like, okay.
How much did that change your life when that happened? Was it just the craziest thing that ever happened to you guys?
Yeah, it was fucking nuts. It was fucking nuts, man. It changed. I had changed the concert. The amount we got paid for concerts, the amount we got paid for features, the amount we got paid for movies, the pussy level.
The TV shit?
The pussy level. Fuck the TV shit.
You didn't enjoy the TV shit that much?
No, I enjoyed it. I'm just joking.
But was that a fun ride, or was that just kind of something you gave it a shot?
No, it was fun.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, man. You can't beat that. It was fun. We had the time of our life. Had time of my life.
You still have people bringing that.
Hold on.
Oh, yeah. Don't stop me. Yeah.
Give me a minute now. I'm just doing the melody, though.
Yeah.
Because I can't really sing like that.
YouTube's going to like pop up like, oh, you have copyrighted material in this video.
No, but we did the melody, though, so they probably won't catch it. Plus, I didn't hit the notes right, so you'd be all right.
Yeah. You get 30 seconds, I think.
I think you get 15, maybe.
You're going to get it for all for free, because they're going to be like, this nigga Fo did an A sharp, and he did like a B flat, so we good.
Oh, man. Hey, is the Mafia 6 dead?
A couple of them is.
No, but are you, you know, rest in peace. A couple of years rest ago, you were peace, super motivated with it. Like, you were super motivated to do this whole thing.
I mean, well, you got all the key figures is gone, man. You know, it's just like... It's like, you know, being Mafia 6 dead wasn't the right way to put it, but I know you didn't mean it like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, as far as the group, yeah, like I said, it was only supposed to be a one-off project. It wasn't supposed to be that, you know. But I'm glad it happened though, because the key members of it got a chance for their dreams to come true before they passed away.
Right.
So that makes it the best, because Coop and Lord, outside of, you know, Crunchy and Coop, you know, they could have went either way.
Uh-huh.
They probably gave a shit if this group ever got back together.
But
they
met the world to Infamous?
They met the world to Lord Infamous, and they met the world to Coopster.
Just to see the group back together after all these
years? Yeah. Because Lord Infamous is my actual family member, and Coop used to live with me as a kid.
Right.
You know, I took Coop from a foster home for the most part. They called it a group home or some shit, whatever the fuck. But so that was like my son and my brother. So it meant the life to them.
Right.
You know, everybody else was just gangsters we met throughout the years. So it meant the world to them. And they was the first two to go.
Right.
So that's what makes that group so special, is because the two people that it matters to the most got a chance to see it happen, and then they passed shortly after. Lord Infamous passed like within 2 months after we did it.
Right, that's crazy.
And I was almost mad at him. I was like, because I did this for you. I'm like, nah, you done left me with these jab niggas. I got. No, I'm joking, man. It was fun. I love everybody in the group. I love Boo. I love Coop. I love Crunchy. Well, obviously, I love Coop. I love Crunchy. I just did a show with Crunchy last weekend.
Right.
I love Crunchy. But, you know, at the end of the day, I'm so happy that I did it, because it was fun to get back in the studio and in the hotels and the tour bus clowning and acting a fool with the whole group like that. Right. You know, Boo, Crunchy, Lord, and Coop, this and that. Even though Lord never even made it to the tour bus part. But Lord was the main reason. Everybody will tell you, Lord was the main reason we did it. And it was just like, once we did it, he recorded his songs, and then he was like, I'm out. I'm finna go to a better place. And you niggas gonna sit down here, and y'all gonna fight for the next couple of years.
Yeah. He got off easy. Yeah, yeah.
You guys, he got off easy. Woo, he got off easy.
Yeah. You guys got all the hard shit ahead of you from here on out, right?
No, it was all good, man. I love everybody. It was fun. And I wouldn't change nothing for the world. Not one piece of it to the day. I wouldn't change for the world.
What's your lifestyle like these days? Like, where are you at in terms of what you do on a day-to-day basis and where you're at in your mind, like mentally, what you wake up thinking about every day?
Man, it's great, man. Like, I live in a beautiful home. I got a bunch of beautiful homes. I got like 8 homes that I own.
Jeez.
I got a small little real estate company. I got a beautiful home out here. I got a beautiful home in Las Vegas. It was on the TV show, Wife Swap, whatever. And like, I don't have no bills. I pay cash for everything I buy. Right. All my cars, all my homes, everything. I pay cash because finance is a fuck.
Yeah.
That's why I start with an F. I stopped financing homes back in 1997 when me and Juicy bought our first two homes. And we bought two homes next to each other. And it was only $125,000 a piece. But this was like when we first made Tear the Club up.
Right.
We didn't have a whole lot of money back then. But we had a little money. We bought these two houses next door to each other. And the house only costed $126,000, my house. Juicy's was $124,000. $126,000, when I looked at, once they add the finance charge and the 30 years of the mortgage, it's going to come out to like $400,000 or $500,000. And I was like, fuck that. I was like, you know how many cars I can get for this? I was like, look, let me just give you this 126 right now and we get this over with.
Yeah.
We shake hands, you go your way, I go mine. And ever since then, I never financed a house ever in my life because I was like, man, finance. If you got to do it, there's nothing wrong with it. I don't want nobody out there to think that there's something wrong with it. Because there's other ways that you can do, you can take that money and do things with it.
Yeah.
Right. But you got to know those other ways. If you don't know those other ways, like I was, if you don't know those other ways, if you're not in the stock market, you're not finna put that shit in. Because right now the banks are not giving you nothing. A bank will give you 0.05% or something on your money. Nothing. You know, back in those days, they was giving you good money. They was giving you 5% on your money.
Yeah.
But still, that wasn't nothing compared to what people was making off the stock market. So they was like, you can get this finance and you can end up paying us like quadruple the price for this house, or you can pay the house off and then you got like another, you know, 300 you can play with.
30-year mortgages are probably not made for people who like go on tour and come back with a couple hundred grand.
Yeah.
It's for like,
it's not made for a musician, period. Because or entertainer or actor,
right,
or football player. Basketball players, that's different because they contracts last. Yeah. A football player, your ass, you go out there, man, you break a leg, they be like, nigga, it's done. They be like, damn, I just put a $30 million house in a layaway because you told me I was getting $500 million.
Yeah.
No. So if you're a football player, a rapper, especially a rapper, and actor, no, man, you can't take them chances. You get your money up, you got to spend that shit right. And that's what I do, and that's why I'm still successful today. Because ever since I was a kid, I just paid cash for every house I bought, every car I bought, everything I bought. Because I always looked at it like this. If I don't have enough to buy this plus quadruple that, I'm not going to buy it.
Right.
Because I know you can be at a sticky moment at any time.
Yeah.
You know, they're not going to buy. I can't be fucking 80 years old on a cruise ship hollering tear the club up. I will.
Is that your nightmare?
That's not my nightmare. I just don't know how the audience is going to react to it. But to be honest with you, they're just groove with it, yeah, just like they do. I mean, it'll be the same fans. It'll be the same fans. They're just not going to get crunk. They're just a... move a little bit, and then they'll clap at it and be like, oh, I remember this song back in 1990.
Yeah, they'll shake their cane.
Are you trying to be like 60 and you don't have to worry about going and playing a rap show anymore?
No, man, I love music. Yeah. I still do music because rap will be just like the Temptations and people like this.
Right, yeah.
They just won't be crunk. Like, it's not going to be like, there ain't nobody going to get hit with a chair.
Right.
Ain't nobody gonna get hit with a chair, and ain't nobody gonna probably, well, they probably still do cocaine in the bathroom, but ain't nobody gonna get hit with a chair, ain't nobody gonna get pulled out on a stretcher unless they have a heart attack,
right,
a cardiac arrest or some shit. Yeah. So some parts will still happen, but then some parts won't. It ain't gonna be no gang banging.
Yeah, now I have this glorious mental image of him performing on a cruise ship for all these
for
like
that
45, 50-year-old like fans that are now basically like classic rock customer type people. Like,
yeah.
That's how it would be.
It probably is how it will be in the future.
I mean, to be honest with you, it's already like that. Because you still have, you can look up and you'll still see people like Dougie Fresh and a lot of Slick Rick and a lot of old school rappers doing stuff like that.
Yeah. But you go play a show right now, it's mostly like young ass kids, right?
Yes, young ass kids.
It's not like 40-year-olds. Like
it's young kids, but that's just because I still make music.
Right.
You know, a lot of those guys, they made hits back in the day that's so big, they don't have to make music no more.
Right.
You know, just like a lot of the rock groups and the 70s groups. And that's actually the easiest way out.
Yeah.
And if 3-6 Mafia stayed together, I could be like that. If 3-6 Mafia stayed together, yeah, we wouldn't have to make no more songs. He wouldn't have never had to make bands and make a dance. I would never have to make whatever the fuck I made. And we could still do Teddy Club for the rest of our life. But, you know, 3-6 Mafia, we just... With me and Juicy, we're such big fans of the music. Like, right, what keeps me out is I'm my biggest fan.
Right.
So I can make music forever just for me. If nobody else would buy it, I put out a song, I get one like, I'd be like, cool. Until I look and I'd be like, damn, that was my like. Oh my God. But I still would do it. I would be one of those dudes because I got a studio. I got my own studio, and I'd be that one guy that'll wake up every day, water the plants like I do, feed the dogs, make some breakfast, say goodbye to the girl, and go to my studio, make a song, sit there all night, fucking drink, and get my guys to drive me home, and be done. And the next day, do the same thing.
Yeah.
for the rest of my life till I die. I could do that.
Yeah.
I got one. I got two final questions. One, do you play Pokemon?
Fuck no.
I already knew the answer. I just wanted to hear you say
people
it.
Running around looking for some invisible.
Yeah, it's totally stupid. I definitely don't play it.
Money, man. I ain't trying to chase a fucking game or something. Yeah, I agree. Don't know what the fuck is
that's
going
some bitch made
that
shit. I can't even wrap my head around
that. That's dumb.
Yeah, that's weird.
It's dumb. I got too much shit to do in town. I'm trying to make these beats and sell these beats. I just produced a song for Big Boy from Outkast.
Really?
Yeah, he got a new album finna come out, and
wow,
I just produced a song for him, and I'm out here, man. I'm out here. I just wrote a bunch of big, like four big EDM songs that's coming out. I write a lot of songs for EDM artists these days.
You write them, and you never get credited for it or anything. You just
like, the ones I wrote just finna come out. Okay. I've been doing an EDM like we talked about. I did the one for TS though back in 2008.
But right. Is it low key?
But then like I stopped doing it.
People don't know that.
Why'd
you
stop?
Well, because we started doing the rap shit. Right, because other people didn't want to do that. But anyway, so this year I made my own little EDM records, like remixes rather, not vocals. Remixes over the years, and every year I do a college tour. And I did it earlier this year. I'm doing two. I did that earlier this year, but usually every year I do a college EDM tour where I go to these fraternities, these frat houses, and I DJ, and we just have a big DJ Paul party. We're just fucking crazy. So I did it earlier this year. Now I'm finna do another one next month and the following month. So this time I'm doing it for the first time. I'm doing it twice this year. So I'll just do EDM remixes myself and just put them out there, this and that, but this year I started writing them for some big artists. So I just wrote a couple of this group called Looney Tunes from Amsterdam and a couple of more groups. And I just did a couple of shows with a couple of those groups. So starting to do more of that because they love it. And it's easy for me.
Right.
Yeah.
It's easy for me because all they want is that one chant.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So instead of saying, writing Tether Club up, then I got to write a couple of verses to it or a verse to it and talk shit on the intro, this and that. I can just write that chant and just send it to them. And they'll loop it and chop it up all kind of ways, and I'm done. Get the check in the mail. It's easy.
Nice.
So.
That's beautiful.
I like doing that.
Hell yeah. Anything else we should talk about here?
No, man. It's been very informative.
Very informative. And I'm happy that the young kids out there who worship the 3-6 sound and maybe don't necessarily know where it really came from, I'm glad that they're going to have this as like a frame of reference. Because we interviewed like so many dudes that like clearly just took notes from you guys, you know? So,
yeah.
Really, everybody in the rap game.
Yeah, 100%.
Everybody in the rap game. I mean, 3-6 Mafia saved rap.
Saved it.
Saved it. Yeah. Really, really saved it. Because if you remember, like, at one point in the 90s, when Atlanta started popping, like the 90s, you know, all that was, you know, that was the sound that the South, that was the sound of the South.
Right.
And all those guys will tell you, like, it's interviews out there with Lil Jon be like, oh, man, you know, I always listen to Master P and 3-6 Mafia, 8-Ball and MJG. This and that. So, you know, all the sound came from us. You know, the whole crunk thing and all that came from us. You know, I give shout out to Atlanta for helping us keep it alive. Because me and Juicy couldn't do it on our own. Memphis couldn't do it on our own. Because the thing with Memphis is Memphis rappers always hated on each other. Mm-hmm. But the thing about Atlanta rappers helped each other. So, like, you'll see a record with Jermaine Dupri and Lil Jon and this person. You know, welcome to Atlanta. Blah, 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 boom. Doom, doom, Ludacris and everybody. You couldn't see a song with Welcome to Memphis with 3-6 Mafia and those guys on there. Man, if you did, somebody would have died at the video set. They came to the studio and did it because they'd be like, okay, that's the way we're going to get some money. But somebody would die at the video set.
Yeah.
So Memphis, you know, shout out to my city. I love my city, but we just never figured out, the rappers in Memphis, we never figured out how to get along. We just never figured out for whatever reason. But I probably because my mama told me this a long time ago. My mom said, "Never trust a city where they killed Martin Luther King yet." I said, you might be right about that.
Put that in your head as a little kid. Never trust anybody from that city.
Yeah, she preached that to me. Never trust a city that killed Martin Luther King.
Wow. Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom. But so anyway, our city just never figured it out how to bond. You know, even today we got big rappers in our city that we still just we can't figure out how to bond. And it'll never happen. You know, to be honest with you, some things in life they say, "Hey man, it'll happen, man. One day we're gonna get this, and one day we're gonna get that." Memphis rappers bonded? No, that'll never happen. that won't happen. And I hate that too because you know I'm one of the people that created Memphis rap. I didn't create it. You know, those guys before me, like A-Ball, New JG, and all that. But
so I heard you to see Gotti and Dolph not able to get along.
No, they can't.
That's never gonna happen.
That might happen with them. I mean, they're young. They still got their whole life ahead of them.
Yeah.
But you know, who never knows? I don't think they will. I don't think they
will.
It's
a shame though, right? Because it's like they could use each other. Like they could benefit from each other a lot by working together because they both are at different levels, different ages, different points in their career.
No, I think they'd be all right.
Yeah, they'd be all right without each other.
Either one of them would be all right without the other.
Yeah, you're really, okay. You're good, right?
Yeah. They don't really need each other. Like they might make an extra couple of hundred or something, and it'd be cool. Got it don't need, dude don't need, got it. They both cool.
What do we need to know about you before we wrap this up, about hour and a half mark?
Man, we got to go, man. So right now, August 8th, which is 808, I got my new mixtape coming out called Mad M.A.D. It's called Mafia All Day. And it's hard as fuck. And it's more like a sampler for the album that's coming out mid-September. And it's hard, man. It's fucking hard as fuck. And I redid one thing the fans need to know. I redid one song y'all been begging me to redo, and it's called Still Get My Dick Sucked.
What? He redid that one?
Yeah. Wow, redid Still Get My Dick Sucked, and it's hard as fuck.
I've definitely gotten my dick sucked to that song a few times.
Exactly. Some hard shit on there. So
you're getting your dick sucked and actually think, like, fuck, this song is insanely appropriate for this moment.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's
exactly.
Good music.
So I got to Still Get My Dick Sucked on there, the part two or whatever it is, and bunch of bump on there. But it's a sampler, but it's full songs. It's a mixtape, but it's just a sample of what the album going to be. The album is called Yachts, YOTS, Year of the Six, and they come out September 16th everywhere. And, man, it's hard as fuck. It's a bunch of songs. You know, it's like 20-some songs on there or whatever, but it's 20 songs or whatever. It is hard as hell, man. I would have to say it's my best work that I've did. We got a lot of people on there. You know what I'm saying? So y'all gonna love it. Project awesome. Pad on there, Juicy on there, Yellow Wolf on there, John Connor, which is Dr. Dre's new aftermath artist on there. There's a ton of people on there, man. It's hard as fuck.
Beautiful. Shit. Thank you, DJ Paul, for coming in and doing the interview. Thank you to Jay Green and Roseman for helping me do this interview.
Yep.
Still almost can't believe it. I said I couldn't believe it in the very beginning. I'm still shocked. I can't believe this actually worked out. But thank you so much for coming in. Yeah,
did you pee yourself?
No, that's why I had to go pee all the way through, like the 40-minute mark.
Yeah, you did go pee. I peed myself, so.
I was afraid that I was going to start
dribbling.
Yeah, I
peed myself, too. Yeah, all right. But that's because I'm drinking too much.
All right, thank you, Paul.
Love y'all, man.
Peace.
Oh, no, I'll put it on the screen.
Oh, yeah. Perfect. All right, it's over. Somebody just broke a bottle.